Okay na? Kita nyo yung ano, yung slide? Na-share ko na?
Yes pa, ma'am.
Okay. So, to put it simply, when we're talking of antimicrobial susceptibility test, it would be just these plates with the antibiotic disc, which work to kill the microorganism. Yun lang sana kasimple. But then, just like with our host microbe interaction topic, wherein we tried to see ano ba meron si bacteria just so it can establish its position sa ating system, considering all of its intrinsic characteristics, at ano din ba kaya ng host just to avoid or just to get rid of the microorganism para hindi rin tayo magkaroon ng infection. Okay? So with antimicrobial susceptibility test, now we say that we're using or we're trying to study now these antimicrobials, which also we could say in the first question ninyo is that some of you answered different answers, of which I place that the answer is antibiotics because we're dealing with the antibiotics. But I can consider, siguro mamaya I'll go over all the answers again, because all of these also belong to your antimicrobials. You have your antiseptics, you have your antibiotics, preservatives, sterilants, disinfectants. Why are they also considered your antimicrobials? Bakit lahat din yan sa antiseptics, antibiotics, preservatives, sterilant? Bakit natin din sila sinasali as antimicrobial? Anyone? Pwede rin na naman tayo sa chat pag wala kayong mga mic. So when we're talking of antimicrobials, bakit kasama sa antiseptics, antibiotics, preservatives, sterilants, disinfectant? Why?
Ma'am, they inhibit the growth of bacteria or microorganisms po.
Yes, Maridine, thank you. Pare-pareho ang role nila. They're all trying either to eliminate the microorganism completely or just to inhibit their growth. Diba, alam niya, antiseptic, sabi nga natin, yan yung mga alcohol natin, then you have your antibiotics, you have your preservative. Why are preservatives considered antimicrobials? They try now to inhibit the growth of microorganisms para hindi masira yung mga foods. You have your sterilants and of course your disinfectants. So that when we get into the actions of these antimicrobial drugs, we're talking either are they bactericidal or are they bacteriostatic. So now, differentiate one from the other. What is a bactericidal antimicrobial drug and what could also be a bacteriostatic? Isang word lang. Pag sinabi natin bactericidal.
Ma'am, hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, bacteri...
Bactericidal. Go, Harley.
Ma'am, yung bactericidal, ma'am, is inhibit yung growth. Tapos yung bacteriostatic is kill, ma'am.
Baliktad ka.
Ay, sorry, ma'am. Baliktad.
Game. Ulit.
Bactericidal kill. Bacteriostatic inhibit.
Good. The growth. Okay. So, bactericidal, you kill the microorganism. Yun ang action ni antimicrobial drug or ni antibiotic. Is dalawa siya. Is either I will kill the microorganism or I will just do a inhibit reproduction. Andun siya, pero hindi siya makaka-multiply so that its action will be lesser. So that would be your bacteriostatic. So that it will now give you this bacteriostasis condition. Okay? So, now going back now to the antibiotic, kasi nga, ang topic natin is your antibiotics or your antimicrobial drugs, from the word antimicrobials, against all of these microbes that are causing the infection. An antibiotic is a substance produced by microorganisms. Going back to your history of microbiology, sino yung unang nakadiscover ng microorganisms from bacteria? Sino? Balik tayo sa micro-review na tayo. Prelims.
Joseph Richter.
Ha? Sino? Sino yung unang scientist na naka-discover ng microantibiotic daw tuloy? Ng antibiotic? At ano yung anti... Si Li Wenhuk did not discover antibiotics, but he worked on the microscope, discovering your animal cues. Alexander who? Alexander Fleming. Okay. Thank you, Charlene and Estella. And also the others around. Okay. So Alexander Fleming was the first one to come up with the antibiotic from which this antibiotic was produced by organisms. So that we have here that this microorganism can either produce them in small amounts that it will now inhibit another microorganism. If you recall the discovery of your penicillin, paano siya na-discover, nakita lang dun sa kanyang growth sa bacterial media, sa culture media, na merong nag-inhibit sa paligid niya. Merong zone of inhibition sa paligid niya. Kaya siya nakita na meron siyang inhibitory property to other microorganisms. So that is our antibiotics. For the different classification of antibiotics, I did not put it here anymore because it is in your module. So you'll just have to go over your module din. Okay? So they can come, sabi ko nga kanina, from the fungi, penicillin, notatum, and then you have also from the different bacteria, which I will have in my succeeding slide. So these are now the microorganisms that could, that were able to produce the different antibiotics. Like for example, from your Bacillus subtilis, and your Bacillus polymyxa are gram-negative rods. And from these microorganisms, the antibiotic bacitracin and polymyxin were produced, or they were discovered that they were able to produce these antibiotics. Whereas for actinomycetes, we have your Streptomyces nodosus for amphotericin B, Streptomyces venezuelae for chloramphenicol, and your Streptomyces griseus for streptomycin. Yun nga sabi natin kanina, meron din sa fungi because from your Cephalosporium species, doon naman na develop ang cephalotin, and from your Penicillium notatum, the antibiotic penicillin. So here now we're showing which organisms did these different antibiotics came from. Okay, so getting into the action of these different antibiotics, let's get into the mechanism of actions. Like for example, if you see the figure now, here is a cell membrane or a cell wall, will be the, they can inhibit cell wall synthesis. So these are the different mechanisms of action of these antibiotics towards your bacterial cell. So that the site of actions of the classes of antibiotics is either on the microbial cell wall, sa cytoplasmic membrane, or in the chromosome function and replication, and in protein synthesis. So you will see in the illustration exactly how they could try to you could see the mechanism of actions of these antibiotics. Like for example, your penicillin would inhibit cell wall synthesis. Your chloramphenicol together with erythromycin, tetracyclines, and streptomycin will play a role in the inhibition of protein synthesis. And we know that protein synthesis is very important for the microorganism after you have the protein synthesis here so that it will be able to undergo cell division. And then you have also enzymatic activity, synthesis of essential metabolites, wherein your sulfanilamide and your trimethoprim will inhibit the synthesis of essential metabolites. And then, of course, your polymyxin B will have injury to the plasma membrane. So lahat yan, na mga action ng different classes of antibiotics are all geared into trying to destroy the organism. Okay, so going back to your microbial cell wall, again, you have your gram-negative and gram-positive cell wall, and the composition of this cell wall plays a role in all those action of the antibiotics. So that, review nyo lang that with your gram-positive organisms, you have a very thick peptidoglycan layer, wherein that peptidoglycan layer is made up of your NAG and the NAM subunits, whereas in your gram-negative, you have a very thin peptidoglycan, but you have a very thick outer membrane. So let's get now into the inhibition of cell wall synthesis. When we are talking about the inhibition of the cell wall synthesis, remember that ano ang role ng cell wall sa ating bacteria? What would be the role of their cell wall? Now, you know that your cell wall is either you have the thick peptidoglycan layer or the thin peptidoglycan layer. What is the effect of these different antimicrobial agents to the cell wall? We're talking already of inhibition. What happens if there is an inhibition sa cell wall synthesis ng ating microorganism or ng ating bacteria? Ano ba ang function ni cell wall sa ating bacteria? Anyone? Hi. Okay. Sabi ni Tam, structure and protection, ma'am. So aside from the structure and protection, your cell wall would keep now your intracellular components also intact. Yes, it can prevent hyperosmotic pressure. It will prevent now the entry or the exit of certain components of the cell. So that ito yung protection niya. Sabi nga, so if you destroy that protection, parang kung may bakod ka, mababa yung bakod mo, and then napasukan ko. So that means that the protection wasn't really good enough. So that what these antimicrobials do, like your beta-lactam, your glycopeptides, your D-cycloserine, and your beta-lactamase inhibitors, now, ang action nila is towards the inhibition of the cell wall of the microorganism. So that in their beta-lactams, our beta-lactams, for example, our penicillin, the mode of action of this antimicrobial drug is the attachment to the penicillin binding protein. Now, dito sa ano na ito, when they attach to the penicillin binding proteins, magkakaroon ng inhibition of transpeptidation reaction. What is this transpeptidation reaction? So that we go back now to, andito ba yung ano, later. So that this transpeptidation reaction, if you remember the NAM and the NAG components of your peptidoglycan layer, where we say this structure, di ba, may cross-linking sila. You have the glycan and the peptide group na para silang mesh, which protects now the permeability or which controls the permeability of that cell wall. Okay? So that what your beta-lactam will do will that they attach to that penicillin-binding proteins and then inhibit transpeptidation so that it inhibits this transpeptidation, hindi magkakaroon ng cross links yun sa NAM and NAG, which will now make your cell wall brittle or hindi mo madidevelop yung structure na yun fully or hindi siya magmamature, which makes it now susceptible to the entry of ang tawag doon, i-imagine nyo yung screen pag kinat nyo yung mga nagjo-join sa kanila, so that now it renders it fragile or ang tawag natin dun? Ang tawag natin dun, pag ganun hindi na siya sturdy or hindi na siya rigid. So that this beta-lactam antibiotics inhibit transpeptidases by acting as alternative substrates. They will mimic your D-alanine, D-alanine, yung substrates, ipakita ko dito. Wait lang, para ano. So you see here, yung sa NAM natin, ito kasi yung MDAC, your D-ALA, or that is your peptidoglycan intermediates, wherein this will aid in the cross-linking of your NAG and your NAM, forming now a mature peptidoglycan layer. So yun ang action ng ating beta-lactam. Okay? So it will mimic your D-ALA ang ano niyan, so that it that is actually your D-alanil or D-alanine. And of course, your beta-lactam now also, its action on the gram-negative is that it will now be producing autolysin, which is an autolytic enzyme. What will it do? It will reshape your cell wall and then this will also aid in cell division so that it will again destroy that peptidoglycan layer. Okay, so that your beta-lactam drugs are your penicillin, you have your aminopenicillin, cephalosporins, carbapenems, and then your monobactams. So you see here that ang action talaga nila is into the cell wall. So even if your the problem with this is that if you remember, sabi natin, ang peptidoglycan layer ng ating gram-negative ay very thin compared to the thick peptidoglycan layer of your gram-positive. But remember that even if our gram-negative bacteria have a very thin peptidoglycan layer, you have a thick outer membrane where you have also your teichoic acid and lipoteichoic acid, and do not also forget your porins, which also try now to protect the microorganisms' intracellular components. So with the glycopeptides, ang mode of action ng glycopeptides is they bind again to the terminal D-alanyl, D-alanine, or again your D-ala of the peptapeptidyl glycosyl peptidoglycan intermediates. So lahat ito, yung mga sinabi natin kanina, your let's go back, your beta-lactam drugs, your glycopeptides, your D-cycloserine, and your beta-lactamase inhibitors, they all try to destroy or inhibit now your cell wall synthesis. Okay? So, your So your glycopeptides, the activity is limited to gram-positive organism. Why now? Why are we saying that it's limited to your gram-positive organisms? Pag sinabi natin glycopeptides, it's limited to the gram-positive organisms. And we're talking here of the inhibition of cell wall synthesis. And the cell wall of your gram-positive organism is made up of anong ating cell wall ng gram-positive organisms natin? Sabi natin, they have a very thick peptidoglycan layer. Anong composition ni peptidoglycan natin? Yes, you have your NAG and your NAM. So, dito kasi, pag sa mga, tawag natin dito, sa ating mga gram-positive organisms, they cannot now cross the outer layer of gram-negative organisms. Kaya hanggang doon, hindi nila makukross si outer membrane. Di ba sabi ko sa inyo nga, even if it has, if it is targeting, you know, the peptidoglycan layer of the microorganisms. And now, remember that your gram-negative organisms have an outer membrane. Kasi si peptidoglycan natin is in between the periplasmic space is between the outer membrane and an inner membrane. So that these glycopeptides are used for the treatment of infections caused by your staphylococci, the gram-positive organisms, your streptococci, and enterococci. Now, another antibiotic also that is used for staphylococcus is your vancomycin. Okay? So, and also you have there your teicoplanin. So how about your cycloserine? Ano naman ang action ni cycloserine? So again, you will see again your NAM and your NAG because this will be always the composition of your peptidoglycan, the gram-positive. And of course, the mode of action is to inhibit the synthesis of the peptidoglycan precursors in the cytoplasm by inhibiting racemase enzyme. Converts now your L-alanine to D-alanine. Okay? So, ganun pa rin ang action ni cycloserine. It prevents the forming of your D-alanine, which are attached to your N-acetyl. Ano na ang NAM natin? Nakalimutan ko na. N-acetyl muramic acid. Okay? So, ganun pa rin ang kanilang action. So, how about our beta-lactamase inhibitors? When we're talking of your beta-lactamase inhibitors, if you remember your, if you have ever used co-amoxiclav as an antibiotic, so this is your beta-lactamase inhibitors, clavulanic acid. You have your sulbactam and tazobactam. So these enzymes, your beta-lactamase enzymes, are their inhibitors are hydrolyzed by the beta-lactamases in the same manner as susceptible beta-lactam antibiotics. So they are used in combination, like for your co-amoxiclav, you have there your amoxicillin plus your clavulanic acid. They are used in combination, protecting them from the inactivation by the beta-lactamase, which is the enzyme. Okay, so how about for the cytoplasmic membrane? What is the mode of action? When we're talking of the cytoplasmic membrane, they act like detergents which interact with the phospholipids, increasing permeability, leading to leakage of macromolecules and ions essential for cell survival. So what are these antimicrobial agents that has this type of action on the cytoplasmic membrane of our microorganisms? So you have your polymyxins, you have your daptomycin, and polyenes. So we'll get into each one again, just like a while ago with the inhibition of the cell wall. Your polymyxin E or polystine is used in the treatment of serious gram-negative bacterial infection. So that here, ano yung mga nagko-cause ng mga serious gram-negative bacterial infections natin? Like for example, we have our Pseudomonas aeruginosa or your Acinetobacter. So, ano ang action ng polymyxin? These polymyxin molecules penetrate into the cytoplasmic membrane. They bind to the phospholipids. They disrupt the membrane integrity and cause now irreversible leakage of cytoplasmic components. So that your daptomycin, this compound inserts itself in the cytoplasmic membrane and drug molecules aggregate together forming channels. It's the last one, itong orange na ito, we have your potassium. Itong ano dito, it inserts itself into the cytoplasmic membrane. And your polyenes, their mode of action is pulled into the membrane interior, destabilizing the structure and again causing leakage of cytoplasmic constituents. So they derive their action from their strong affinity towards sterols. Saan na ulit ang ating sterols? Saan yung makikita si sterols? Ay. Where do you see your sterols? What type of microorganism? Hello? To treat those that lack cell wall organisms, okay? They don't have, and then yes, Israel from your mycoplasma, okay? So that your polyenes now, they derive their strong affinity towards sterols and also from the ergosterol, which we see in the membrane of our fungi. Now, another one would be the inhibition of the folate synthesis. Ano yung folate synthesis? Now, in here, you will see two enzymes. You have your dihydropteroate synthetase and your dihydrofolate reductase, which is on your left side of the screen. And then the action now of your antibiotics or the group of antibiotics wherein you have your sulfonamides and your trimethoprim. So folic acid pathway, the folic acid pathway provides the essential precursor molecules needed in the DNA synthesis. So that here, your dihydropteroate synthetase will now aid in the formation of your dihydrofolate, whereas your dihydrofolate reductase now into the formation of tetrahydrofolate. But in the presence now of this antibiotic, your sulfonamide, hindi mo po-form na mamaya si dihydrofolate. Si trimethoprim naman, hindi niya ngayon ma-form. As a presence niya, hindi ma-perform yung tetrahydrofolate. So that if these are not in the folic acid synthesis, ma-inhibit yan, then you will not complete your DNA synthesis, and hindi yan makukomplete, walang cell division. Okay? So, how about for our chromosomes? You go back to your chromosomes now. You remember your unwinding of your DNA chromosome, the replication and transcription, and eventually also your translation into proteins. Now, antibiotics can also work on that is on disrupting these processes. So, unwinding, remember that yung sa inyong DNA, your double-stranded DNA, naka-coil siya, you have to unwind that one to allow access of your polymerase enzyme to produce new strands of DNA. What is that enzyme that you will need there para magkaroon ng new strands of DNA? You will have to, your DNA gyrase, topoisomerase, or that is your topoisomerase 2 because you have topoisomerase 1, 2, 3, and 4. See, gyrase is your topoisomerase 2. And then also in the replication, that your unwound DNA, di ba na-open muna yung DNA mo, yung strands niya, now binds with the Albers protein to keep it unfolded. Now, your transcription is the copying of single strands of mRNA sequences, and this is carried out by RNA polymerase. So, ano ang role ngayon ng ating antibiotics dito? What are the antibiotics affecting chromosome function? So, you have here your fluoroquinolones, you have your nitroimidazole, nitrofurans, rifampicin, rifabutin, and your 5-fluorocytosine. Okay, let's go. Si fluoroquinolones, ano ang kanyang mode of action? So all of these now, the mode of action of your quinolones is that they bind and interfere with DNA gyrase and topoisomerase 4. So that if they interfere with this, what would happen? Sabi natin kanina dun sa unwinding, replication, and in transcription. We said earlier that your topoisomerase 2 or your DNA gyrase, what does it do? Pag nag-unwind, anong role ni topoisomerase 2 natin? Alu? Pag nag-open na yung ating stranded DNA, double-stranded DNA, what is the role of your DNA gyrase and your topoisomerase 4? Asan na kayo? Strands po, ma'am. Produce new strands of DNA, ma'am. It will initiate the production of strands of DNA. So, pag in-inhibit mo yan, walang, anong mangyayari? Pag na-inhibit si DNA gyrase at saka si topoisomerase 4, what will happen? Will happen? Anyone? No DNA synthesis po. So there will be no replication of your DNA. Okay? So for your metronidazole, what does it do? Your metronidazole now will cause DNA strand breakage by chemical action because the nitro group is converted into nitronate radical against anaerobic organisms. And this nitro group is reduced by, of course, another enzyme, your nitroreductase, leading to generation of cytotoxic compounds and free radicals that will now disrupt again the DNA. So we're talking about now the chromosomes. And you have there your nucleic acids, which is your DNA. So for protein synthesis and its selective inhibition, the process of protein synthesis involves the ribosomes. Diba yun ang function ni ribosome natin? So that mRNA, a series of amino acid transfer RNA molecules, and accessory protein factors involved in for the different process of initiation, elongation, translocation, and termination. Now, in the inhibition of protein synthesis, you have now chloramphenicol and your aminoglycoside aminocyclitol antibiotics, or the AGA. So what is this? They attach to either the 50S for your chloramphenicol and the 30S. These are your ribosomal subunits. If you remember the large ribosome and the small ribosome dun sa ating translation, ikikarry niya si tmRNA ba or si tRNA carrying the amino acids. So you have there also your 50S and your 30S. These are your ribosomal subunits. Now, ano ang action ng ating aminoglycoside, aminocyclitol antibiotics, or the AGA? It is to interfere with the initiation and assembly of the bacterial ribosome so that it will lead to the misreadings on the codons on mRNA. So, you know what happened when there is a misreading on the codons? What will happen? Kakaroon ng bakit merong name unavailable?
Mutation po, ma'am.
Kakaroon ng mutation. Okay. So that, if there is now, pag nagkaroon ng mutation, meron kang misreading of codons, what will happen to your organism?
Ma'am, magkakaroon siya ng defects. Depende dun sa mutation.
Teka lang, tignan ko muna sino yung Nolan? Si Nolan ba yun?
Yes, ma'am, ako yun.
Okay. So, in the absence naman of our agak, ito na yung mga codon natin. You have phenyl, polyphenylalanine of your codon is UUU, and then you have your polypropylene sa codons ninyo, CCC. And of course, streptomycin binds tightly to one of the protein components of the 30S subunit, which again will prevent initiation and assembly of the ribosome. The streptomycin binds to 30S subunits, and again, it will distort your ribosome. So we're talking kasi here of the function of your ribosome, which is in protein synthesis. So, aminoglycosides are often used together again with penicillin in order to diffuse and enter the bacterial cell. So, your macrolides, example ng ating macrolides would be your streptomycin. Ang mode of action naman ito is it selectively inhibit protein synthesis by another process with blocking translocation through binding now to the 50S subunit. So it is by blocking the translocation process, erythromycin now causes release of incomplete polypeptides from the ribosome. Okay, so those are the different actions of the different antibiotics just to get rid or just to have this bactericidal or the bacteriostatic effect on the microorganisms. So we get now into the test. How do we do that? So that is what antimicrobial susceptibility test is. This is used to determine which specific antibiotic a particular bacterium is sensitive to. So makikita na natin dyan sa growth ng microorganism sa ating petri dish. That is our antimicrobial susceptibility test. And there are two methods. You have the diffusion method and the dilution method. And the most common of these is the diffusion method. An example of your diffusion method is your Kirby-Bauer dish diffusion method. This Kirby-Bauer dish diffusion method is inexpensive, and it is very easy to perform. So how do we do this? What is the principle of your Kirby-Bauer disc diffusion test? It is a standardized suspension of organisms is inoculated onto your Mueller-Hinton agar. This paper disc impregnated with specific antibiotic concentrations are placed into the agar. Then after 18 to 24 hours of incubation, diameters of zones of inhibition are measured. Results are compared with established values to determine the organism's susceptibility or resistance to each antibiotic. So I'll get this opportunity now to explain one of the questions that was posted in your activating prior knowledge, wherein you were asked if you had a zone of inhibition, would that mean that that organism is already susceptible to that antibiotic? So nakita mo na may zone of inhibition, diba? Naglagay ka ng, kunyari, naglagay tayo ng disc. And then, dun sa paligid ng disc, merong zone of inhibition. Would that already tell us that that antibiotic is effective for that organism? Was it true or was it false? Sino nag-answer ng true? At sino nag-answer ng false? Halo. Take note of the results are compared with established values to determine the organism's susceptibility or resistance to each antibiotic. Now, CLSI, clinical and laboratory, anong SI niya? Systems? Yata, sorry, hindi ako. Basta ito yung nag-i-issue, they try to update the table showing us the zone of inhibitions wherein we can tell whether that or that antibiotic is effective for a certain microorganisms. Okay? So, hindi porket nagkaroon ng zone of inhibition, ang ating antibiotic, ibig sabihin nun ay susceptible na siya. Susceptible na yung organism dun sa antibiotic na yun. Okay? So, in doing your AST or your antimicrobial susceptibility, remember that we said you have a standardized suspension. Ano yung standardized suspension? Ano yung standardized suspension of organisms? Now, we need to standardize our inoculum. Kung ano yung we start from is standardizing the inoculum so that we have the standardized number or density of microorganisms into that inoculum. So, ano saan natin i-compare ito para malaman natin that we have this 1.5 times 10 to the 8 colony-forming units per ml ng ating inoculum. So, we compare that with a 0.5 Macfarlane standard or your 0.5 Macfarlane turbidity standard. Kasi baka mamaya sa exam, tinanggal ko yung turbidity, hindi na naman niya tatanggapin. So, in the preparation of this Macfarlane standard, this is your, actually your barium sulfate. Why barium sulfate? Because it is made up of your 1% sulfuric acid and 1.175% barium chloride. So, we prepare a 100 ml preparation of your 0.5 Macfarlane standard by combining ba tawag dyan, 99.5 ml of your 1% sulfuric acid and 0.5 ml of your 1.175 barium chloride. So that when we're talking of this Macfarlane standard, this is your barium sulfate. So that this should be stored at room temperature lang, it's kept in the dark. So that this is the usual reason why we have to place it into an amber bottle, protect it from light. And its stability is about 3 to 6 months. Then, the inoculum preparation now, you have your bacterial culture, is diba, when we do a culture and sensitivity, the sensitivity there would be your antimicrobial susceptibility test, is you need to inoculate first your clinical sample or your clinical specimen onto a media. It can be a general media, or you can use your blood agar plate. Again, sabi nga natin, you always try to inoculate it into three culture media. And then, from there, you will be picking isolated colonies. So, when we're talking of isolated, kung gaya ng mga nagawa nyo na nung nag-inoculate kayo, you can clearly see isolated colonies with the same colony morphology. Hindi pwede mag-pick lang tayo ng meron kang nakitang mucoid, may hindi mucoid, merong gray, merong medyo maputi. So, they should same the same colony morphology. Ano yung colony morphology natin? We'll be talking about the size of the colony, the consistency of that colony, and then titignan nyo din yung kanyang elevation, yung kanyang margin. So, in short, magkamukha sila or magkapareho sila. So that yung magkakaparehong colony na yun, kukuha kayo ng mga 45 isolated colonies and then you inoculate that into a broth medium. Preferably your TSB, but you can also use your NB, which is your nutrient broth, or your TSB, your triticase soy broth. Okay? After incubation, you will now compare that with your McFarland standard. So how do you compare it with that McFarland standard? You need now to use also a weaker ham card. Ano yung weaker ham card? Yan yung board na nasa likod nitong dalawang test tubes natin wherein you have these dark black lines. Ano ang purpose ni dark black lines? Kasi if you're able to see through the black lines pareho, tingnan nyo yung kunyari, nilagay mo yung McFarland standard mo together with your test culture suspension or your inoculum, then those black lines should be the same in both tubes. For you to say now that your inoculum corresponds to your McFarland standard so that you know that the density of the bacteria in your test culture suspension is also 1.5 times 10 to the 8 colony forming units per ml. Kasi yun ang kailangan mo for your AST. Yan ang i-inoculate natin doon sa ating Mueller-Hinton agar. So, na-standardize muna so that if the test culture is darker than your McFarland standard, then you can dilute it in water or again to the broth that you have used for the inoculum. So, i-ano mo lang siya, i-dilute mo lang siya. You can get a sample from your test culture. Kasi kung maraming kinang i-add, so you need another test tube, sterile tube. Then you transfer some of that and then you can dilute it with water, distilled water, or with the broth that you use for preparing your inoculum. Hanggang magpareho sila ng turbidity ni McFarland. Okay? So now you have standardized your inoculum. Now you're going to swab it onto the MH plate. Anong mali dyan sa picture? Anong napansin yung mali dyan sa picture? This was lifted from the PowerPoint of Dr. T.V. Rao. Anong mali dyan? Ha? Okay, aside from not practicing aseptic technique, ano pa? Aside from not practicing aseptic technique, sabi ni Tam, walang gloves. Aside from walang gloves, wala na siyang aseptic technique, wala pa siyang gloves, ano pa? Ano pa? Kung saan nag-start yung grab, masyadong open yung culture medium. Okay? Sige. Hindi nyo nakikita yung nakikita ko. Anong bawal sa laboratory? Manner of holding the plate. With regards to the manner of holding the plate, Vincent, may nail polish, naka-manicure siya, char, totoo yan, naka-manicure. Bawal ang manicure bawal ang long nails sa laboratory. Now, I'll just get back to the manner of holding the plate. Okay? Diyan, whereas I showed you during our laboratory demonstration the proper holding of your plate para ngayon sa opening and closing mo. Remember that I told you din naman that is what is recommended, but it will still depend on you on how you can hold your plates or your petri dishes that is most convenient to you, as long as you will be avoiding contaminating your culture media. Okay? So, in this slide kasi, sabi ko, oy, naka-manicure pa siya. And then, you know, parang long nails pa siya. Those are a no-no in the laboratory. For the obvious reasons, naalam na natin yan, that microorganisms can get into your nails din. And bawal ang nail polish. Okay, thank you. So, ngayon, pwede na muna kayong mag-nail polish kasi wala tayong mga laboratory. But when you get to your internship, lahat yan bawal. Bawal ang long nail, bawal ang manicure, bawal ang kulay sa buhok, bawal ang hindi nakatali ang buhok, and all those things. Okay. So, with the swabbing now, kasama kanina sa inyong exam, ano, kaya nilagay ko na doon na do not write streaking anymore kasi ang dami ko nang ilalagay na choices. Overlap streaking, overlapping streaking, and all those things. And with the Moodle app, dapat ilagay mo lahat yan, pati kung may space, walang space, may ang tawag niyo doon? Anong tawag doon sa line na gano'n? Yung sa Mueller Hinton kanina? So, kailangan yun. So that, dito sa ating AST, the manner of streaking would be your overlapping streak. Okay? Overlapping in a way that paikot-ikot mo yan, so that when you have streak, okay, maraming line yan, so that you streak onto one line, magkakadikit. You're not doing your zigzag thing na meron ka talagang spaces. With your AST, you would like to make sure na walang space, na walang inoculum o walang microorganism. So that once you have a streak it on one side, on the plate, in one direction, dire-diretso ka lang, you turn your plate again and try to do it the same way like you started streaking, then you turn it again, siguro mga 60 degrees, 60 degrees, 60 degrees, then streak ka thoroughly onto the surface of the media, and then you also try to wring the sides of your plate. So making sure na lahat yan, meron kang sample ng iyong standardized inoculum. Okay? Yun yung sinasabi natin ng may term din dyan sa AST, confluent ang iyong inoculum onto the surface of your media. Okay? So that after you have inoculated your standardized inoculum, you let it rest for at least 15 minutes. That is now for your microorganism, for the inoculum to diffuse into your MH, onto your Mueller-Hinton agar, before you start to put your antibiotic dish. We have a lab lecture din dito, so we'll just go on that further sa ating lab lecture. So, ito na yung after na-incubate nyo. So, you have the growth. Makita nyo yan. Maganda ang growth. Pantay lahat. And then, you will get now your zone of inhibition. Depende na ngayon sa antibiotic natin. And, so, ito yung sa plate talaga. Nakikita natin, there are only 4 antibiotic discs here that were placed because the choice of your antibiotic or your panel would depend on the microorganism that you're trying to check, kung saan ba siya susceptible o kung saan ba siya resistant. So, specific na lang yun sa mga laboratories. So, measuring is of course by the use of your vernier caliper, or if you do not have a vernier caliper, then you can use your ruler. You're measuring now the from one side to the other, the zone of inhibition. And, kung makita niyo dito sa photograph, So that if you were going to measure your antibiotic dose, andito pa lang sabihin ko na walang zero zone of inhibition. Okay? Bakit walang zero zone of inhibition? The space where you have placed your antibiotic dose will not have also a growth sa baba niya. So that is a mga 6 millimeters. So usually kasi ang intindi natin kasi when we say zero zone of inhibition is parang kung tignan mo itong plate na ito, merong disc na talagang walang zone of inhibition. So we do not write a zero zone of inhibition. No zone of inhibition lang. Okay? So you measure your zone of inhibition by your vernier caliper or a ruler. Then this is now the interpretation of breakpoints. This is always your clinical and laboratory standards institute. Meron din tayong European clinical standards, EUCAST. So this is our clinical and laboratory standard susceptibility table. This is updated depende sa mga databases. CLSI always try to do their own antimicrobial susceptibility testing doon sa microorganisms na talagang nag-change ng susceptibility na to certain drugs. So that this is periodically updated. So ito yung breakpoints kanina. So that let's take for example your methicillin. It contains now your 5 microgram. So that we say that it is susceptible if the zone of inhibition is greater than or equal to 14 millimeters. So that it is resistant kung less than 9 siya. But take note that if your antibiotic dose is 6 millimeters, so that makikita mo dito that your zone of inhibition may be baka mga 3. So that if you have a zone of inhibition of less than or equal to 9 millimeters, then that is already considered as resistant siya. Okay? So may zone of inhibition ka dyan. Pero yan yung sinasabi ko kanina na kahit may zone of inhibition ka, kung hindi yun yung dapat na zone of inhibition ng antibiotic to that microorganism, then hindi mo pa rin masasabi na that microorganism is susceptible to that antibiotic. So ito ngayon yung mga zone of inhibition ng different microorganisms wherein masasabi mo siya ay susceptible to that. Then you have there your intermediate and of course you have here your resistant. Okay? Ito yung mga zone of inhibitions nila. So another method, sabi natin, was the dilution susceptibility testing. So we had diffusion for your Kirby-Bauer method, and now we have your dilution susceptibility testing, which is another method. Ano si dilution susceptibility testing? Now we have here your minimal inhibitory concentration or your MIC, and also your minimal bactericidal concentration or your MBC. So dun pa lang sa word na inhibitory and then you have your bactericidal, these are two different situations or conditions again of the test. So what is minimal inhibitory concentration? So we'll get into that now. Your minimal inhibitory concentration is one in which you will be seeing visually a tube that will tell us na parang wala ng growth ng microorganism. Okay? So, there are two types here. You can have the tube dilution or you have the agar dilution. Sa tube dilution natin, pwede siyang macro dilution or micro dilution. So that when we're talking of macro dilution, then you are using the regular test tubes. And the micro dilution, you will be using your micro titer wells. So, ito ang principle ng ating dilution susceptibility testing methods. Anong principle niya is that dilutions of an antibiotic are added to your Mueller-Hinton broth and a standard concentration of the inoculum. The tubes are incubated overnight and read visually for turbidity. Remember that when we're using a broth media, we're checking for turbidity as the indicator for bacterial growth. So that the lowest concentration showing no visible growth or macroscopic inhibition is the MIC or your minimal inhibitory concentration. Now, these broth cultures showing no visible growth are again subcultured into appropriate agar and incubated to determine if the organism has been killed. So, nandito na tayo sa killed na word so that this is now your bactericidal concentration. Yung kaninang inhibit lang, that is your minimal inhibitory concentration. So, we say that the MBC is the lowest concentration of antibiotic that exhibits at least 99.9% killing. Okay? So, in short, when we're talking of your dilution susceptibility test, makikita na natin dito yung minimal inhibitory concentration ng ating antibiotic. And at the same time also, it's minimal bactericidal concentration. So this is how it is done. So you have again your serial dilution. Discuss na natin ito dito anyway, and dito na yung slide ko. So that you will do again your serial dilution. It's a two-fold dilution wherein now you have different test tubes. And you will notice that the concentration of your antibiotic, ito yung sa ating antibiotic, you have 200 microgram per ml. But then you'll do a serial dilution so that it will have now your 50, 25, 12.5 hanggang maging 0.19 siya. In any experiment in microbiology, you always have different cultures. For this, you have your inoculum culture, you have your control. You have your inoculum control, you have your broth control, and then you have your antibiotic control. So your MIC will be seen here so that if you have done your serial dilution, and then you will now add your inoculum into each tube. Like for example, your inoculum will be in tube 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and of course in your inoculum control. Okay? So lahat yan meron na, and then you incubate it, and then after 18 to 24 hours, and then you check your tubes, ito na ngayon ang result. So that if you look at the tube, sabi natin ng MIC, you're checking the tube visually for turbidity para makita natin, because turbidity is your indicator that there was growth in your media. Okay? Our media here is your Mueller-Hinton broth. So as the tubes 1 to 4 or 1 to 5 ninyo, clear yung test tube so that we will say that at tube 5, this is now your minimal inhibitory concentration, that at 6.25 microgram per ml of that antibiotic, it was able to inhibit the growth of the microorganism. So that is your MIC. Kasi kung nag-turbid na si 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and onwards, then alam natin na hindi niya na-inhibit ang growth ng organism. So that your MBC will be checked or will be taken only when you have subcultures, all of these tubes, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, onto an appropriate media, again, a solid media, your plated media. You again streak all of this dito sa inyong media, and your MBC, since we're talking of bactericidal, ibig sabihin, walang natirang microorganism, or that antibiotic was able to kill 99.9% of the organism that was in your inoculum, then that would be your MBC. So ano ang difference dito? We said that your MIC was at tube 5, but your MBC is in tube 4. Because in tube 4, nung sinab-culture mo siya sa plate, wala na talagang nag-grow. It is in that tube that the antibiotic was able to kill, so it had the bactericidal effect on the organism. So that your MIC is in tube 5 because it still had some growth that is not just, that was not seen visually, parang tingin natin clear, pero meron pa palang buhay na microorganisms doon. But that antibiotic was still able to inhibit the growth of the microorganism. Okay? So your MBC is a tube 4. The MBC of that antibiotic is 12.5 microgram per ml. Its MIC is at 6.25 microgram per ml. Okay? So what are we testing here is now the concentration of the antibiotic that would be able to inhibit or to kill the microorganism. Okay, so this is our micro dilution, which uses now your micro titer plates. What is the advantage of micro dilution, of using broth micro dilution? You have here a micro titer plates. With your micro titer plates, you can put now different antibiotics agad. Like you can, makita natin dito, you have already tested 3 antibiotics against a single organism. So that here you have clindamycin, penicillin, and erythromycin. In contrast, when you're using the macro dilution, isang antibiotic lang ang tinetest natin among 12 test tubes. So that if we were going to test 3 antibiotics, then we will be using also 36 test tubes. You will be doing your dilution in all of those. So medyo very tedious ang procedure. And with this micro dilution tray, meron kang micro scan, or you will be reading it onto a machine. Ipapatong lang si micro titer plate din para ma-visualize mo at makita mo kung ano yung kanyang MIC. Ano yung MIC ng ating antibiotic. Okay? So, we have other dilution methods also, or other other AST tests like your E-test, which is a gradient diffusion susceptibility testing, wherein we're using plastic strips. Kikita yung plastic strips. Nasa lab din kasi ito. But just to get into it, your E-test uses this plastic strip. So, ganyan ang itsura niya sa inyong plate pag tinest natin siya. You put this plastic strip. Itong plastic strip na ito, at one side, andun yung antimicrobial agent concentration gradient natin. And then, on the front, it contains also, kikita natin ito yung numeric scale that will indicate now the drug concentration. So, ang MIC niya dito would be the point, itong ellipse yung mag-meet yung dito sa nakikita nyo na parang nagpo-point na part ng inhibition. That is now your MIC. So, you just correspond it with the numerical value on the strip. Again, we'll have more of that sa laboratory discussion. So, okay. So, we get now to the acquired mechanism of resistance. Bakit nagkaroon ng, di ba sabi natin, some microorganisms have developed resistance already to these antibiotics. So, that these mechanisms of resistance are to destruction or inactivation of the drug, rapid efflux, which pumps the drug out of the cell before it can become effective, and prevention of penetration to target site within the microbe. What are the different target sites? Sabi natin kanina, you have the cell wall, you have the site for protein synthesis, you have your cell membrane, and also with the DNA synthesis, and of course, the alteration of drug's target sites. So what are those? How are we going to check for this one? So that addressing antimicrobial resistance will lead now to the modification of existing drugs, identifying other targets for antimicrobial activity, and of course, the development of antimicrobial peptides from other sources. So, special screening and indicator test for antimicrobial resistance. So, we have here, marami ito nandun sa notes nyo. But I'll just get into four. You have your oxacillin screen plate wherein this is for the detection of staphylococcal resistance to penicillinase-resistant penicillins. So this is used to detect your methicillin-resistant staphylococcus aureus or your MRSA or yung tinatawag na MRSA. So it contains, this screen plate of oxacillin contains now your malar hinter agar supplemented with 4% sodium chloride and 6 microgram per ml oxacillin. So what would be the positive result for this, for your oxacillin screen plate? Positive result, of course, will still be growth of more than one colony on agar medium after overnight incubation. Whereas this is now indicative that the isolate is oxacillin resistant. Okay, so that this will show us now that the organism is resistant to oxacillin kasi nagkaroon ka ng growth damage. For your population analysis profiles, this is more for the use, vancomycin resistance wherein you have your VISA or your VERSA in contrast to your MRSA, your methicillin resistant staphylococcus aureus. Here, it is now with vancomycin. So that when we say that your staphylococcus is vancomycin intermediate staphylococcus aureus, is that you will be able to see ang MIC niya, you will see, ano na ulit ang ating MIC? That is your minimal inhibitory concentration. So that if the MIC of your staphylococcus aureus will be 4 to 8 micrograms per ml, then that would be, the interpretation for that would be that it is vancomycin intermediate staphylococcus aureus. Whereas, if you will be getting now an MIC that is greater than or equal to 16 micrograms per ml, then we can say that that staphylococcus is already vancomycin-resistant staphylococcus aureus. So that the test for this one would be your macro e-test method. And of course, this is testing now for another antibiotic. Ito kasi yung pinaka effective against staphylococcus aureus infection, it should be your vancomycin. So that pag naka-develop si staph aureus to vancomycin, naka-develop ng resistance si staphylococcus to your vancomycin, then meron tayong dalawa general interpretation, is either it is intermediate susceptibility or you have your resistant staphylococcus aureus. Okay? Gets yun, baka na ano, yung ano SA staphylococcus aureus, hindi nyo ano na ano ko lang yung susceptibility. So that your SA there is your staphylococcus aureus, your V is your vancomycin, which is the antibiotic, and of course the I or the R is either intermediate or resistant. So that will be represented by the concentration of the antibiotic. Okay, so that if at 4 to 8 milligrams, doon magkakaroon ng inhibition, that would be your vancomycin intermediate staphylococcus aureus. Kung sa greater than 16 microgram per ml, then that will already be your vancomycin resistant staphylococcus aureus. Okay, so we also have the D zone test. Ano naman itong D zone test? So kanina we had oxacillin, and then next was your vancomycin. For your D zone test, this is now for clindamycin resistance among again our Staphylococcus aureus resulting from efflux of macrolide. You have your efflux of the MSRA gene. Kasi dun sa vancomycin you have, or your MEC gene, your MEC-A gene for Staphylococcus aureus. Ito yung mga part dun sa ating sa genome ng Staphylococcus aureus, which carries now the innate resistance of the microorganism. Okay? So, natawag siya na DITES because now you have here two antibiotics that are placed side by side. You have erythromycin and your clindamycin. So, that dun sa clindamycin, because it's the antibiotic being tested here, makikita natin yung blunting of clindamycin zone na nagbibigay ngayon ng parang D-shape nung zone of inhibition. So, pag nagkaroon ka ng ganitong zone of inhibition, a positive D-test na will indicate the presence of macrolide, which is the inducible resistance to clindamycin. So that is for your D-zone test. And again, you have your vancomycin agar screen plate, but this is more for enterococcal strain to vancomycin. So it's again testing or screening for vancomycin resistance of our enterococcus. And another one is your beta-lactamase test. Ano naman ang ating beta-lactamase? This test is to identify your beta-lactamase production in organisms. So how do we do this? For example, in beta-lactamase, if your organism is producing beta-lactamase, so you have this disc, magkukuha tayo ng inoculum ng microorganism, and if that microorganism produces beta-lactamase, the disc will turn into brown, red, or parang pink. You inoculate the disc with the colony of the organism. So, pag negative naman siya, hindi mag-change yung ating disc. Okay? And the last but not the least that will be shown here in this discussion will be your MALDI-TOF MS. What is your MALDI-TOF MS? This is your matrix assisted laser desorption or ionization time of light spectrometry. We'll explain this further sa ating laboratory. This is now the latest or the most updated spectrometry for bacteria yeast. It can also be used for lipid analysis and protein analysis. Okay? So, ito lang yung procedure ng ating MALDI-TOF MS process. So, we'll discuss that in your microbiology, and also in your laboratory. Okay, so, I guess this is the end of our AST lecture. If you have any questions, any clarifications,